Hi, everyone, and welcome to Water Resistance. My name is Margaret Osipian, and I'm part of the curatorial team for Sonic Acts. After being immersed in smog and digging deep into soil at our previous night air installments, this time we'll wade into water with a special edition curated by Sonic Acts artist-in-residence Ameneh Solati. Ameneh is one of six artists and researchers who are residents in our overexposed program, each undertaking a period of remote artistic research. We're here in the streaming studio in Rotterdam with our wonderful live stream team, and we're also really lucky to have Ameneh joining us in person, and our speakers and moderator will be joining us online from different locations around the world. Water Resistance is the third event as part of Night Air, a series of online transmissions that aims to make visible pollution visible by bringing forth the various side effects of modernity, from colonial exploitation of people and resources to perpetual inequalities brought about by destruction of the environment and common land. Tonight's program brings together ongoing stories on water bodies as sites contaminated by power relations. It aims to embed ecological struggles within the narratives of nation building, development, and modernization with talks by architects and researchers Merve, Bedir, and Menna, Agha, alongside Ameneh Solati herself, and a panel discussion moderated by artist and curator Moad Musbahi. Following the individual talks and conversation, we will end the evening with a live thematic soundtrack dedicated to tonight's topic by DJ Laser Gazer. So don't leave when it's over. There'll be a little follow-up after the event. So before coming into the live stream tonight, you landed on a page that gave you the option to join the talks, where we are now, or to watch a film. And so we're very happy to be screening Turbulent Flow, which is directed by tonight's moderator, Moad Musbahi. We're also excited to say that this screening is a small premiere since the film was just finished a couple of days prior. You'll all get one of the first peeks into this film. So turbulent flow is a type of motion that is characterized by chaotic changes in pressure and velocity. In such a condition, one system begins to pick up and carry with it parts from other systems. Using calculations such as predictions and simulation, the flows of water, sand, and air are represented photographically ever closer to the real. Borrowing from these abstract systems, border regimes and surveillance technologies have developed methods to project patterns of displacement and the migration of people as scientific fact to justify policies of policing. Yet movement and migration inherently deny such reductive reasoning. Turbulent flow is an intrusion and disruption into the extrapolations of the real, shifting between flows to attempt and expose the problem posed by bodily presence and the mechanisms designed to impede them. The film started today at 4 p.m. and it's playing every half an hour, and you can watch it until Sunday at midnight, Central European summertime, just so you know how long you can watch it. It'll just be looping and looping, so you can kind of come in at different moments in the film. So during the talks in the Q&A session, we invite and encourage you to engage with the discussions via the live chat that you should be able to see on the right of your screen. And Mirna from Sonic Acts is moderating the chat and is going to relay your questions to Moad, who will bring them into the Q&A conversations. When you share your question, please specify who it is directed to, if that's something that's relevant to your question. So before we continue, I'd like to note that during our conversations and in the chat, we urge you to abide by the Berlin Code of Conduct, which Mirna will share the link to. This code of conduct sets the expectations on how we encourage you to engage with one another. Please exercise consideration and respect in your speech and actions, and refrain from demeaning, intimidating, discriminatory, or harassing behavior and speech. So tonight's event brings together ongoing stories of people's resistance to subjugation and forced displacement. With that in mind, before I pass the stage over to our guests for tonight, I would like to read the statement of solidarity with Palestine that Sonic Acts issued and shared publicly on Friday. Sonic Acts stands in solidarity with Palestine and condemns the crimes against humanity committed by the State of Israel. As an arts organization presenting programs that stand against the colonial exploitation of people and resources, we feel the need to make explicitly clear our support for those resisting decades of Israeli settler colonial occupation in Palestine, including the dispossession from land and life, ethnic cleansing, and ecological devastation. We endorse the statement first published and disseminated by the Graduate Gender Program and Netherlands Research School of Gender Studies at Utrecht University, and encourage other cultural organizations to join in this solidarity campaign. Mirna will share the contact email in the chat that other organizations and associations willing to endorse the statement can send an email to. In addition, all proceeds from tonight's ticket sales will be donated to Think About Others, which is a nonprofit association providing urgent medical aid in Gaza. With that being said, I'm very happy to introduce our moderator for tonight. Moad Musbahi is an artist and curator who works between London and Tripoli. He utilizes exhibition making, video installation, and writing to investigate migration as a method for cultural production and political expression. Through researching the movement of stories, people, and sound, he focuses on the social practices and forms of knowledge that displacement engenders. His works have been presented at the Architectural Association, Jameel Art Center, and Beirut Art Center, amongst others. He is a recipient of the Sharjah Art Foundation's production program in 2020 and currently a resident at Gasworks in London. We're all very much looking forward to the presentations and the conversations, so I'll pass the stage over to Moad, who will appear in the stream after we take a little swim together.
Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for that very kind and generous introduction. And to preface the evening tonight in solidarity with Palestine, I just want to firstly extend a kind of gratitude to Ameneh for the initial invitation, and to Anne and everyone at the Sonic Axe team that have been so incredibly generous to host this event this evening, and who've amazingly and majestically developed this website and built the kinds of visuals and the settings that we are seeing today, which is a very welcome break from the monotony of the Zoom interface. And it's a website that's currently being hosted on a URL that ends with "from the river to the sea." So I'm just going to spend a few moments here actually going to read a poem to kind of set the stage and to contextualize "from the river to the sea" as a kind of space that exists between two bodies of water. And so I'm just going to read something quite short from Muhammad al-Kurd, who's a resident of Sheikh Jarrah in Jerusalem. And it's a poem he wrote in 2014 called "No Moses in Siege." And it goes, "Was it because there were no more graves in Gaza that you brought us to the beach to die? Was it because rubbing us in our homes, like our cousins, like our futures? Was it because there were no more graves in Gaza that you brought us to the beach to die? Was it because our cemeteries needed cemeteries and our tombstones needed homes? Was it because our fathers needed more griefs? We were limbs in the wind, our joy breaking in the shore, soccer ball in between our feet. We were soccer in between their feet. No place to run. No Moses in siege. Waves stitched together, embroidered, weaved, unwalkable, indivisible, passage implausible. On most days we weep in advance. We look up to the clouds. Here we know two suns, Earth's friend and white phosphorus. Here we know two things, death and the few breaths before it. What do you say to children for whom the Dead Sea does not part? What do you say to children to whom the Dead Sea does not part?" So this is a poem that he had written in 2014 in response to the four children who were massacred on the beach in Gaza, Muhammad, Zakaria, and Ahad al-Bakri, two Muhammads al-Bakri. And the phrase "from the river to the sea," which is about the land of Palestine between the two bodies of water, the River Jordan and the Mediterranean. And it's a term that has a long history. And essentially, it's a plea for unity, for a kind of place that makes no distinction between religion or race, and such one that does not try and demarcate arbitrary divisions between land or between people. And so this evening, we're going to be joined by a series of different talks that have been brought together by Ameneh, including Ameneh's her own work. And in it, there is a place in which water, the resistance to water, the ways in which water is used and mobilized against others, and the ways in which then those imaginaries and linguistic possibilities that such bodies of water and bodies of knowledge allow are going to be hopefully dealt with and thought about from various perspectives and from their various places. And so without much further from me, I think I would like to just introduce Ameneh. I'm very excited begin here the introduction. I think we are going to go for a little swim before. Swimming together. So Ameneh Solati is a Rotterdam-based architectural designer, researcher, and editor. Her practice engages with interdisciplinary methods in exploring forms of resistance within often overlooked spaces. She completed her MA in architecture in 2017 from the Royal College of Art in London. She's currently an editor and organizer at Failed Architecture, an incredible publication, and I encourage you all to check it out, and has previously worked at the Hot New Institute in Rotterdam, alongside other various architectural practices in Amsterdam and London and beyond. So I'm very excited to hear just Ameneh, and I leave it to her.
Thank you, Moad, for the introduction and for sharing that poem with us. And a big thanks to all the organizers at Sonic Acts for providing me with this opportunity to bring us and our water stories together, and also for their support during my residency. Hoping our talks would create ripples, if not waves, in how we relate to social injustice to environmental injustice. The research that I will be presenting is focused on one site, the Mesopotamian marshes in Iraq, a unique environment dating back to the establishment of the first civilization ever known, a site that to this day is loaded with contradictory connotations, from being the Garden of Eden to being the site of incivility, or a site of refuge and resistance. The reason for choosing the marshes as a research subject is not because I come from the exact same area or because my practice is particularly focused on ecological or environmental issues, but I approach it through my own generational experience with the same oppressive regime that the marshes and its inhabitants were subjected to. So for many of us that have faced such oppression, or our families have been, we know that our spaces, our practices, our tools, our symbols extend in unpredictable ways in order to self-determine, resist, and survive. Whether be it by adopting the watermelon as a symbol for Palestinian flag when the colors were banned, or walking miles on foot to the saints to seek justice when we are unheard. The marsh people's story reveals a unique story of control and resistance, where the natural environment is woven into every part of their history, enabling us to redefine a water body and the natural environment as a political space contaminated by the hegemonic authority, what I call power pollution. I will take us all through this by highlighting two strategies of control. First, how the marshes were transformed to influence the inhabitants. And second, how the inhabitants were influenced to transform the marshes. And finally, I will end with the current situation. In 1991, following 8 years of war with Iran and only a month after Iraq invaded Kuwait, an uprising against the President Saddam Hussein started in the south and north region of Iraq. They slowly spread to most Iraqi cities. It was met with violent attacks by the Iraqi military in their effort to take back control of the cities. To seek refuge, Kurdish insurgents fled to the mountains, and the Shia in the south fled to the marshes. Though the topography of the highlands is very different to the topography of the lowlands, they both offered an impenetrable area out of safe reach. The revolt grew in coalition between the insurgents and the marsh tribesmen. The marshlands stood out as a natural defensive perimeter, allowing for the insurgency to continue long after it ended in the cities. The marshlands, once covering an area of approximately 20,000 square kilometers, consisted of swampy terrains, waterways, lagoons, growths of reeds, humans, and species of waterfowls and wildlife. The lowest lands of Iraq forming the marshes have a direct one-sided relationship with the highest mountains in the region. The lowlands almost completely rely on snowmelt from the mountains in Turkey and Iran. The seasonal upstreams, floods the rivers Tigris and Euphrates, are what sustains the marshes. As they flood the lowlands, they mold an extensive maze of waterways and reed beds. This seasonal shrinkage and expansion of the wetlands results in bodies of water periodically changing shape and contours. These shifting edges, therefore, to the outsider were illegible and unmappable. The marsh people, however, are able to navigate these waters through watercrafts orally inherited and practiced from childhood. As the Iraqi government struggled to enact control and take over the marshlands, it resorted to direct forms of violence by poisoning and electrocuting the water, as well as burning the villages. However, as a further punishment for allowing infiltration and contributing to the insurgency, different strategies had to be put in place. To dispossess the marsh people of their wetlands is an event with temporal edges. To ensure permanent change in the relationship between the marsh people and their environment, the entire ecosystem rather than a specific group of people had to be targeted. It was strategic to put in place infrastructures that would maintain these goals long after the removal of the people. Therefore, the regime deployed another form of violent but less direct strategy. Saddam gave directives to divert water from the marshes through building a series of water infrastructures, which successfully drained 90% of the marshes within 2 years, displacing the marsh population to neighboring Iran or internally within other cities in Iraq. The drainage did not only displace the inhabitants, but annihilated species of plants, fish, animals, and birds. This project involved an array of techniques and devices, from constructing dams, canals, sluices, barrages, dikes, channels, polders, causeways, artificial lakes and rivers, and raising embankments. Each impacts the marshes differently, either by diverting water, evaporating water, or blocking flow. Most of these infrastructures were promoted by the Iraqi government as irrigation projects to encourage the economic, social, and cultural revival of the area, all the while giving these new developments contradictory names that directly reference the resistance of the marshes, such as Al-Qadisiyah River referencing a historic battle that Arabs won over the Persians, Mother of the Battle River, Fidelity to the Leader River, Crown of the Battle River, and other names such as Prosperity River and Saddam River. Adding these water infrastructures to the widely spread propaganda apparatus popular at the time was another way of asserting the state's domination on the natural environment and its inhabitants. Although this was the first time desiccation of the marshes was achieved through such a large scale and at such a quick speed, it was not the first time the Ba'ath regime attempted to enact control on the environment of the marshes. To control the uncontrollable was always on the agenda, regardless of the rationale. Previous to the uprising and the drainage, the Iraq-Iran war started and took place in the 80s. It was most intense in southern Iraq. The regime understood the importance of the marshland ecology in maintaining the people's livelihoods as well as maintaining resistance to authority. Besides the threat that the marshlands presented, its geographic location by the borders with Iran made it stand out as a vulnerable geographic area for national security. The slide before. In order to gain a grip on the marshlands, governance had to extend to the peripheries. To achieve this, they used high modernist technopolitics. According to a research that was made possible due to governmental documents and correspondence found by Americans during the invasion and currently housed in their institutions, in 1984, at the president's directive, various ministries submitted recommendations for how to deal with the provinces that were at the center of the marsh problem. The oil ministry recommended new filling stations, and the interior ministry proposed new police barracks closer to the troublesome waters. The local affairs ministry sketched the most elaborate program, including connecting the marsh villages to the electrical grid and introducing irrigation projects to force the marsh people into modern agricultural techniques. To begin, they recommended surveying and then leveling land to make room for paved roads and bridges, which would help encourage the roaming marsh dwellers to finally become sedentary. More importantly, they also recommended elusive methods of extending control. The health ministry submitted a list of locations for new clinics and other public facilities, and the interior affairs ministry recommended floating schools and opening up local marketplaces. all seemingly in the favor of the marsh people. But these development plans to provide healthcare and education were a way to classify and discipline bodies. That is precisely how infrastructures of care can also be means of governance and control. Health clinics, schools, and such facilities can contribute to uneven relations and homogeneous forms of living. According to a speaker of the Iraqi parliament, the government's intention was to relocate the inhabitants of the marshes to houses along the highways, to provide them with electricity, clean water, schools, and medical care, and to make them good citizens. In this particular case, Iraqi school curriculums were geared towards encouraging civil service. Many of the marsh families whose sons left the villages to urban centers blame schools for teaching their students to resent their village life by presenting them and their practices and culture as backward and uncivilized. To truly influence the subjectivity of every Iraqi, and not only the marsh people, the national project under the Ba'ath regime extended its tactics beyond defining a national identity, to define the Iraqi identity. And that meant the ideal man and woman with ideal mannerisms, dress code, familial structures, systems of production, allegiances, alliances, spiritual relationships, ethnicity, and race. However, the natural environment, whether it be the marshes or the mountains, doesn't only offer refuge and allow for resistance, but also generates multiple identities and modes of living, with unique associated practices different from the rest of the population. As such, the marshes pose a challenge to the state's preferred homogenized national identity. As these distinct identities could seek independence, this was of great threat to sovereignty. And therefore, the ideal civilized Iraqi man and woman also meant the ideal environments. It was a two-way strategy of changing the environment to influence the subject, but also influence the subject to change the environment. These goals effectively were very similar to colonialist efforts to reduce the vernacular in every possible way. The attempts to bring the periphery into line was justified by colonialists as providing civilization and progress. However, in reality, they were violent acts that led to loss of independence and freedom for many groups under colonialism. In fact, these plans to drain the marshes were not completely the idea of the Ba'ath regime. They were inspired by frameworks and plans drawn by British engineers at different moments in the history of the region prior to the regime. With the first dating back to the beginning of the 20th century. They resulted in a series of dams and water infrastructures around the country and also beyond in the region. Relocating the marsh people to urban cities also had a major impact on gender roles. Next slide. The homes in the marshes were mainly used to sleep and eat. In the marshes, women's most activities would take place outside the home, whether it be cultivating, cooking, or weaving. Activities that contributed to both the family life as well as community and the economy of the village. By displacing the marsh women and relocating them to areas and homes sanctioned by the state, they no longer were able to practice the same activities and as a result, limiting their agency. In yet another tactic, prior to the formation of Iraq under the British mandate, different ruling powers in the history of the region attempted to immoralize the marsh people through abusing their name. The marsh people in Iraq as an ethnic group are known as the Ma'dan. There are different possible etymologies. Some claim that it is in relation to the word Ma'dan, meaning metal, and in Arabic it can refer to the original or the indigenous. And the word Ma'dan came about to refer to the indigenous people of Mesopotamia. However, the term was promoted since the Ottoman rule as a derogatory term in response for the marsh people's rejection of the occupying powers. The term was broadly used as a slur with different implications, such as to describe appearance or mannerisms as lacking good taste or an uncivilized person. This marshland history dating back to thousands of years of resistance and revolt against oppression was perceived by ruling powers as traitory, criminal, or immoral. This, combined with the history of cultural production as a measure of moral character, has left a general perception that the marshlands was a haven and a shelter for thieves and outlaws. Besides the marshes, often the rural population, and especially those living in different geographic terrains, are seen as barbaric or primitive people. However, the criminality or barbarism attached to the marshlands and its people is based only on the fact that the marsh people rejected structured and systemized forms of state governance. And therefore, their practices, regardless of what they were deemed criminal. To this day, many continue to describe the marshlands through official and unofficial platforms as an environment of lawlessness where criminals sought refuge. And many Iraqis still abuse the name of the marsh people ethnic group, knowingly or unknowingly of what it references. This reveals the strategies that were put in place decades ago to continue to undermine an entire ethnic group and their practices and culture, but also the natural environment of the marshes. This attached perception of the people and the modes of living within the marshes is also associated with the perception of the natural environment of the marshes itself, and even every other natural environment in its many different forms. The perception that lands or waters where government has no or very little influence is a lawless space renders the natural environment as either uninhabitable or only fostering crime and immorality, further creating a separation between man and nature. If you are to imagine the mountains, the desert, the jungles, the wilderness of these environments also extends to the wilderness or barbarism of the inhabitants. However, not only the natural environment has an ecology that at times says definitive and stable relationships and forms of mutual agreements between natural elements, humans, and non-human beings, but the human inhabitants also form their own modes of living, of social structures that rely on self-governance, kinship relationships, and symbiotic relationships with their environment. To reverse the logic of why some choose to live far from the urban centers within extremely different environments allows us to also question how civilizations and evolution is defined. As James Scott poses in his book, The Art of Not Being Governed, once we entertain the possibility that the barbarians are not just there as residue, but may well have chosen their location, their sustenance practices, and their social structure to maintain their autonomy, the standard civilization story of social evolution collapses utterly. These attempts to incorporate the marsh people were disguised as development, economic progress, literacy, and social integration. But in reality, it meant the marsh people can be governed, their economic activities are made legible, taxable, and confiscatable, or failing that, replace them with other forms of productions that were. This is an evidence of how the marsh people succeeded not only in fine-tuning a system of supply and demand to maintain their self-sustaining ways of life, but in producing serious economic outputs through food production. Being independent and productive members of the society without being under the regime's control would not be allowed. As it was said at a conference on the marshes, had the marshes really been either the Garden of Eden, the idol of idleness, or a distant, poor, and sparsely populated subregion, it would not have attracted Saddam's attention. So what happened after the fall of the Ba'ath regime? Or shall I ask, during the fall of the Ba'ath regime? Just as the regime was falling, and before American troops entered Iraq, the marshes were the first site that liberated itself. It did not wait for the Americans nor for the new Iraqi government to welcome them back. They took matters into their own hands, breached dikes, and initiated reflooding of the marshes. Next slide. Here we see in the background a satellite image of the current situation with the superimposed declassified photographs taken by U-2 spy planes in the 1960s. We can see a village in the central marshes and some dwellings. Today, some parts of the marshes are reflooded and the marsh people are returning. However, it is far from being habitable the way it used to be. The water is slowly being reduced by water infrastructures in Turkey and Iran. It also suffers from high salinization and pollution, and the region is struggling with rapidly increasing climate change. The following governments, however, recognize that these neglected wetlands, which are relegated by most past governments, are of great value to economy. No more than a year had passed since the American invasion. American government agencies and European private companies were already drawing up plans to invest in the marshes by transforming it into an eco-tourist site named New Eden. It includes a project to rehabilitate the area for returning marsh people to facilitate the open museum project. They designed two types of villages, water villages and land villages. From just a quick look of the old dwelling and the new proposed housing for the marsh people, we can already distinguish that previously there was an intentional separation between each dwelling, which allowed for water mobility. Back to the last one. Whereas the new structures that are being built, they have eliminated that deliberate strategic positioning. And also their modes of production, as they have tried to incorporate modern agriculture techniques by providing each a separate plot. James Scott also argues that generally anthropologists and historians take forms of sustenance and kinship relations and cultural identities as a given, as ecologically and culturally determined. But through this analysis, it reveals to us that the mobility, the social structures, the modes of living should be treated as political choices or strategic positioning by the inhabitants of the marshes. This is not to say that the marsh people don't want improvements or don't want more stable structures or don't want clean water, healthcare, or even access to internet. But the new projects attempting to recreate the old ways of life the marshes, the marsh people led do not take into account the thousands of years of indigenous knowledge or their need for autonomy. So it is essential that we start to expand our definitions for political space to include the natural environment and include the resistance of its inhabitants. Simply, to expand our definitions is to expand our fight against injustice. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mifa. Incredibly rich and lucid talk, and I think also the kind of very poignant end around the ways in which it is dimensional and generational on a few levels, both across people and terrain and environments, but also in terms of language and tools and notations that we use. So thank you so much. I think now we're gonna have a short flurry and then introduce our next speaker. Okay, so I'm super happy and honored to be introducing Bedir, who's an architect, usually based in Hong Kong and Shenzhen, so I think he's been subject to some displacement and relocation over this last few months. And her ongoing research has examined infrastructures of hospitality and mobility. She's an adjunct assistant professor in Hong Kong University's Department of Architecture in the Division of Landscape Architecture and is a founding partner of Land Civilization Compositions. Merve holds a PhD from the Architectural Engineering Department at the Delft University of Technology and a Bachelor of Architecture from Middle East Tech University in Ankara. So I leave the ocean floor to her.
Bu suyun akımı daha tarih öncesinde daha başkaydı. Daha dibi derinmiş mesela. Daha derinmiş mesela. Şu an sıvı. İçinde gemiler geziyormuş mesela. Taşımacılık yapıyorlar. Doğudan batıya bir ulaşım yani. Bulgaristan'a, Yunanistan'a. Göçmenler var mesela. Siyahi göçmenler. Onlar geçmek istiyorlar. Suyun sıvı olduğunu, sıvı olduğunu zannediyorlar. Aslında bazı yerlerin derin olduğunu hissedemiyorlar. Onu göremedikleri, bilmedikleri için boğuluyorlar.
The video work you are watching now is called Reflections from Marriage by Nikolai Larsson. And you are listening to Harim, who is a fisherman who is also a laborer along Maritsa River. Maritsa in Bulgarian, Meriç in Turkish, or Evros in Greek, is known with two major events, especially in the region of Balkans. One based on undocumented and illegalized migration, that is based on the European border regime and Frontex regulations, because Maritsa River holds a large part of the national borders among Greece, Bulgaria, and Turkey. And the other is the destructive floods that happen every spring in the city of Edirne and in the city of Alexandropolis in Greece, where Maritsa reaches the Aegean Sea. This makes Maritsa River continuously a geopolitical issue, not only one for Bulgaria, Greece, and Turkey, but also at the EU level. On the one hand, Turkish state continuously warns Bulgarian state to have better water management on their three dams along the river. And on the other hand, Bulgarian and Greek states, as well as the EU, warning Turkey to have stronger migration control along the river. Can I have the next slide, please? In this way, actually, claimed sovereignties on Maritsa River hold a shared history, and maybe the only shared history among modernity, capitalism, and socialism. By attributing national identities to and border control on the river, and by developing expertise on controlling the river basin with locks, dams, and other infrastructural interventions, an ideology of the Anthropocene is clearly visible on Maritsa's boundaries. This full control on Maritsa River goes together with controlling and managing the mobility of Armenian, Jewish, Turkish, and Romani peoples along Maritsa River throughout its history. This concurrence includes memories of population exchange, forced displacement, and illegalized migration, where bodies were included in the same narrative and action of management and control of river. The images you see here are satellite images that are just maybe 2 weeks separate from each other in March 2006, taken from the NASA satellite MODIS, Rapid Response. And also below, you see the aerial photography showing the flood basically on the same days in place. In the next slide, we see basically how the river is known today, especially in Bulgaria, with its strange smell, mosquitoes, and polluted waters. This is more or less how we were hearing the responses from the people in the different cities in Bulgaria who live along Maritsa River. It's pretty much a forbidden and abandoned place, especially in the city of Plovdiv, where we focused our work on, except for the fishermen and the nomadic Roma people, who maybe share the same faith as the river. Uncommon River, a festival I curated in Plovdiv, in Bulgaria, one of Maritsa cities, initiated an open river library that collected the histories of the peoples and the river, connecting these histories to the present-day perception of toxicity and abandonment. I'll tell you part of this knowledge from the River Library, focusing on political violence, both as the ideology of Anthropocene and control on the movement and daily lives of peoples along the river. The next slide, please. Here you see two maps and a coin, the image of a coin, the round one on your left-hand side on top, is from the National Archaeological Museum in Athens. And it depicts Ardakos from 5th century BC, the god of river, Maritsa. It's symbol and protector at the same time. It's interesting because this river god is not known to any local peoples along the river, except for Greece, because of the displacement, that the population exchange that happened after the First World War. Another representation of the river is the one that you see just below the coin, which is called the book. It's actually a map that you see from the Book of Pleasant Journeys into Faraway Lands, created by Muhammad al-Idrisi in 12th century. This map shows the northern shoreline of Marmara Sea, Gallipoli Peninsula, Aegean Sea shoreline from the delta of Maritsa River to the peninsula, Macedonia, and parts of Greece. And on the right-hand side, you see Thrace, a map by Abraham Ortelius in 16th century, a Brabantian cartographer and geographer, Abraham Ortelius is. He is conventionally known, recognized as the creator of first modern atlas, theater of the world. This map is also known to be the first, one of the first maps guiding economical conquer and exploitation of other geographies. So here, basically, the suggestion, and these are really what some of the first representations of the river, where, let's say, a certain spirituality and a kind of voyage and, let's say, fascination, and then on the other hand, a kind of economy of exploitation comes into to play in the case of the representation of the river. In the next slide, you see, again, according to our research within the team, that was another representation of the river that we were able to find from 14th century, so just before Abraham Ortelius. This image from the Topkapi Palace archives, actually. And actually, it might be one of the first drawings from the eye level, but it actually depicts Battle of Maritsa as a frontier of Ottoman Empire's policy of spread, and actually another symbol of conquering. In the next slide, I guess my first emphasis is about how images are a continuation of ideologies in representation. So, and with that, this photo, and where we kind of have the technology of, let's say, displaying, showing, representing in other ways, in the 19th century, early 19th century, how, let's say, a history of modernization is documented in the case of Maritsa River. The first railway built along and across Maritsa, connecting the river cities with Istanbul, the capital of the empire. The next slide shows actually how, let's say, before modernization and around modernization, let's say around the First World War, Maritsa River was basically an important regional network across the Balkans, and very particular to Balkans. It's not very much known in Europe as part of the river networks. Here, one of the important things is to mention the Roma people, who were kind of encouraged to be in mobility along Maritsa by Istanbul. And in addition, we have the rich building beautiful houses by the Maritsa River, as well as their efforts of small-scale agriculture in the riverbank, and so on. So for the people living by the river, there was clearly an understanding of being part of the river and supporting this. The decisions regarding the livelihoods, including Maritsa, were made in networked local governments. Next slide. In 1885, so we are already later in the 19th century, Maritsa River actually was a frontier again, this time to the events that led to the Bulgarian national unification. With the establishment of nation states of Bulgaria, Greece, and Turkey, a population exchange was organized, and the non-Bulgarian people living in the country were forced to move to the respective nation states and the other way around. The national borders among Bulgaria, Greece, and Turkey were drawn tracing Maritsa. The river held a very strong image in the identity of Bulgaria Republic, and the river was utilized as a militarized space and representation. In the next slide, we still see how much actually, even then, let's say up until the Second World War, still we see this attitude and behavior of being by the river and spending time by the river. More or less in the city scale, in smaller scales, beyond, let's say, the representation of the nation state, we still see this kind of being by the river, clean waters, swimming, sailing, carrying goods and people in and along the river. Even if the train infrastructure created a certain ideology of detachment and modernization actually of the people from the river, because it was more about transportation of materials and things, the interactions between the river and the people pretty much continued. In the next slide, you will see actually public baths along the river, agricultural production and continuing, ongoing. keeping these different human and non-human agencies aligned in the context of the river. Next slide. After militarization and the ideology of the nation state represented in the river, we actually see the water management becoming a strong agenda of socialism. So we are already here talking about the Second World War time. And really a kind of investment in water management. Major national level investments on setting up a railway network and decentralized industry along Maritsa, which comes back as, let's say, the complaints of smell and the pollution of the river nowadays. The river was no longer part of local decision-making starting in this period, but more centralized at national level. These interventions were made on the riverbed, rechanneling the water flow, changing its volume and speed, mastering it with expertise. This ideology basically made the river into another kind of infrastructure space of utility and management. Dams and locks, industry and international fairs, railroads and bridges, detaching people more and more from the river. Basically, all of the water management infrastructure that we see today along Maritsa mostly built immediately after the Second World War. The 20th century, which brings us to the point that the 20th century ideological battle of capitalism versus socialism, which we saw very much present, apparent around the Second World War and afterwards, which occupied and divided Europe, was actually unified in the shared pursuit of triumph over the river and the water. Next slide. Here, basically, you see a newspaper article from 1957. On the left and on the right-hand side, similar, let's say, reporting. 57 year marked with significant floods, especially in the city of Plovdiv, with a lot of deaths and missing people in these incidents. Precautions were about more engineering interventions, like changing the course of the river, building a flood wall, and introducing new species, completely changing the nature of the river. Next slide. One of the things that modernity did in Bulgaria was to replace the water god in this case, if you may refer to Ardakos, with the church. It also shifted the locus of nomadic Roma people from the river, who assume water as a force of nature to guide human beings' morality, to the architecture of a shrine as a political tool to strengthen nationalist belief. Roma people were pushed to get citizenship and settled in social housing in different cities along Maritsa. So basically, a nomadic people whose livelihood very strongly and spirituality and rituals very strongly referred to the river were kind of forced to live in the cities still by the river, but not, let's say, related to it. This actually relates to, the floods themselves. So it wasn't necessarily, let's say, a conscious decision to settle and displace Roma people from the river, but because the river space was dangerous because of the floods, people should not come close to it anymore. So agricultural activities were forbidden, Roma people were forbidden from the water, and so on. In the next slide, we basically see how we ended up with with a riverbed that belongs to the state and the infrastructure, with river banks that belong to the cities, which were separated by high walls, which also channelized the river. And we ended up with swamps that result from these management attempts. The riverside was forbidden to go by. Agriculture was forbidden to be done in small scale by the river. This might be actually the ultimate moment of a forced distance from the water and the river. Next slide. We see actually in Plovdiv, the city of Plovdiv, we see this going to the most furthest extent. With 1990s, we see the sports complex being built by the river, but having nothing to do with the river. We see industrial fairs and new industry coming into the riverside and having nothing to do with the river. We see large-scale privatization of land and infrastructure which also was happening by the river and had nothing to do with the river. So really, I mean, gradually, the river kind of, both in national scale, in European scale, and in local scale, it kind of became like that had no belonging and no ownership by any peoples or anybody with any cultures, let's say. After 2000, there are European Union programs established, including Maritsa, such as Natura 2000, actually a very interesting and important framework program that's about ecology and sustainability on European rivers. And for instance, Green Balkans is a major NGO that works on the river with the same focus. But this was interesting because the reaction from people were more in relation to, oh, now Maritsa became European. So in a way, there was this kind of, let's say, trust or lack of trust to the governance programs at large. In the next slide, you will see one of the maps that we did only for the city of Plovdiv, where we show actually the transformation of the river channel, the riverbed, the darker color showing the existing channeling situation and the lighter color showing how the original situation was. And then next slide, you see the changing of the riverbed and sand mining, actually, which happens more towards, let's say, Turkey or more towards Aegean Sea, where the river falls into the sea. And in both cases, you see how much, actually, the nature of the river was kind of even taken away from itself. So in a way, again, like the faith of the river kind of goes together with the faith of the people and the other way around. The next slide, we talk about how, let's say, agriculture was part of daily life along Maritsa and very much took place by the river. And then this time, let's say, together with more globalization attempts and European attempts, what we see is more, and actually even more international attempts, be it Marshall programs followed by other programs from overseas and even programs coming from China related to different agriculture produce from corn to rice, which are actually species that are indigenous to the local but replaced by, let's say, hybrid species from overseas, are kind of put together or, let's say, put against or to confront the knowledge that was produced especially by the river, by the people who live by the river. So in this case, again, I want to refer to the way that the Roma people especially, and the way they treat animals by treating them as beings with their own experience and interests in a largely human-centered world, acknowledging their agency both for the animals and for the plants, and sharing authorship with them as collective production. This kind of experience that kind of that is super abstract on the one hand and super concrete and real on the other hand, indeed kind of emphasizes the oxymoron or the problem, the conflict of, let's say, both as humans and as non-humans, how this kind of river, the nature of the river was altered. But together with the people that belong to it. In the next slide, I'm coming to the end of my presentation, and here maybe one thing that I would like to emphasize, which also came up in Ameneh's presentation, in the face of climate change programs in face of climate change and the respective programs that are developed, let's say, in the scale of nation state again, or in the regional scale, or in the case of European Union, a concept of ecological civilization and citizenship is promoted for a sustainable and financially successful country. In this, I'm saying in relation to Bulgaria, where basically the perfect citizen beautifies the city, promotes ecological public spaces of Plovdiv, and protects his environment. Environmental ideology of ecological civilization melded together with ecology, patriotism, and nationalism through ecological citizenship, quote unquote, this last part. To me, this kind of, with the conflicts and the problematics that I tried to raise before, this sounds more like an oxymoron, because carrying the slogan of ecological civilization, the state sustains its capitalist utopia of infinite growth and unlimited consumption of natural resources, then maybe climate change only becomes the justification of continuation of control of nature. And this I would like to put forward as a point of discussion. In the last slide, or the last before the last, we see basically another view on the river in the video. It's a very short video that will last about 30 seconds, where you will see the Frontex border mechanisms, digitalization of the river space, let's say, and their use of technology for extreme monitoring of humans and non-humans, using 27 monitors, sensors and monitors over a kilometer square of area, for instance, in this case, what you see on the video. Among national borders, between an assumption of nature and culture, public and private, European and non-European, Maritsa River still sits as an infrastructure of care and living together, but transforming from that to an infrastructure of trauma and displacement for the humans and also the non-humans, showing and being the evidence and the witness of the violence on the river. Just to conclude the last slide, actually, Wami, a collective from Iraq, and this image is painted by Yasin Wami, who painted it to show Tigris. But he kind of, he was also suggesting that this belongs to Maritsa. And he wrote this text from Roma people, as he found out in his conversations during his visit to the to Plovdiv at the time. He was talking about the Ederlezi, the Roma water ceremony that is done every 5th of May, going into the river and cleaning yourself with the sunrise. This ceremony represents the energy that animates the land, the same energy that runs through us all. The relationship between Roma people and the river is interesting. They believe all things in nature are interconnected and in constant occurrence. All things in nature arise from an ultimate source that resists objectification. Vitality and growth is the very nature of existence. Nature exhibits consistent patterns that can be followed, and in particular, patterns and interaction of cycles. And I leave you with that. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Merve, for that. Also kind of an incredible long and kind of cross-like section in terms of both methodology and thinking through the river as subject of study, as well as methodology and method to begin to kind of unpack and think through different aspects. So it was really inspiring also to see in a kind of short tangent or adjacency with some of the work in the film around the ways in which these kinds of protocols or techniques of trying to map and determine and define these kind of water bodies in the end destroy them, right? And so that kind of inversion and kind of undeclared intention of mastery that inevitably is their demise, which is really powerful to think about. I think we're kind of another slick transition to Menna, who has perhaps also, so super excited for the final and incredible kind of talk we're going to hear. And also I have to say an incredible curating around like all these M's, Merve, Menna, and Moad. It's easy to introduce on the tongue. So Menna, Agha is an architect and researcher who's currently in Cairo. She was a 2019-2020 Spatial Justice Fellow and a visiting assistant professor at the University of Oregon. Currently, she's coordinating the Spatial Justice Agenda at the Flemish Architects Institute. She holds a PhD from the University of Antwerp and an MA from Cologne International School of Design. She is a third-generation displaced Egyptian-Nubian, which we will hear through many ways, and which will open up her talk. So I leave it to Menna.
Hi. I hope you're all hearing me well, and I would like to apologize in advance if there are any issues with my internet. I just would like to point out that internet connection and speed is a luxury not afforded to everybody on Earth, and I am now in Egypt, so internet has been doing some things with me these days, so I'll apologize in advance. And also, if you see that I look like I'm melting, it's really hot in here, and I can't turn on the fan. Otherwise, you will hear some really unsavory noises. And speaking of noises, I am very excited and really thankful that Sonic Acts and Ameneh has invited us to hear and listen to water and to our rivers. I listen to all of you, and I feel like our rivers are in kinship that we are yet to explore. There are relationships. Even their struggles look so much alike. I am today coming to talk to you about my river, the Nile, and how Nubians who loved the river were displaced from it, but not just that. I'm looking at how the river was weaponized against Nubians and how the water they loved so much and was the reason they had settled in this part of the earth in the first place became the weapon through which they got kicked out and displaced and uprooted from their land. Are you all hearing me okay? Are we all good with sound? Okay, I'll keep checking. Sorry for that. Now I invite you to listen to this sound. That's the sound of a water wheel. This noise that you're going to hear is one of the most impactful and most influential in Nubian conscience. So, I ask you to, I ask the team at Sonic Acts to play it for us if they can. So what you just heard is the sound of a Nubian man describing what happens to the water wheel, but to describe that, if you're an Arabic speaker and you recognize the Sudanese South Egyptian accent, you would recognize that they are describing water passages and how the water moves and how does it come to the water wheel. And each step of these movements gets a name, and everything gets named and everything gets recognized. Water gets pampered coming into that water wheel. But the important noise that I wanted you to hear is that cacophony in the background, that noise that you might have been bothered by is one of the most important noises in Nubian consciousness, pre-displacement, because it means that when water is low, it still comes to us. And when the river is in its lowest levels, there is this technology, there is this place, or there is this apparatus that can bring water to us, and that brings in a very specific, very special affect to Nubians, and that noise became basis to a lot of Nubian music, musical styles and Nubian songs. In the maps you see in front of you, so the water wheel I'm talking about is that image on the right hand side, all the way to the bottom. The maps you see next to you is a summary of what happened to Nubian land over the past 120 years. So starting at 1899, when the line was drawn between Egypt and Sudan by the British colonizer, that was followed by a series of damming projects that has been titled the Low Dam in Aswan. And with that, the British colonizers were trying to control water in the south so that they can farm comfortably in the north and extract even more resources out of Egypt. With that, the water started to rise up and drown Nubians in their sleep. And the river that they loved so much started acting out against them. The river that they understood over centuries started doing these strange things, and nobody really told them that the water is going to rise. So in 1904, and 1933 was a warning, but in the first two heightenings of the low dam, Nubians did not really know that the dam was going to raise water. And my grandfather writes stories of his grandmother telling him about how the water came in and drowned people in their sleep, and how this was a nightmare, apocalyptic situation that remains in Nubian consciousness, and really is rarely told. It's a story that is rarely told in Nubian studies in general, as it's not really documented in formal archives. It comes to us from our stories of our grandmothers. Well, after the low dam has been devastating Nubian land and not just drowning people in sleep, but also eating up all this agricultural land, Nubians started to migrate, and Nubian men especially went onto a diaspora, working in the city centers, and Nubian women remained to have a Nubia remain. So Nubian women had to become Nubia to stay there. Then after the post-colonial state of Egypt was initiated, and Abdel Nasser took the rule, he needed a new pyramid. He just needed a new pyramid for Egypt, and he needed a new pyramid and as a state-making technology. And he decided to build a dam and control this river even further. And this was the biggest disaster in Nubian livelihoods in the past 100 years, despite the fact that the low dam has been cutting Nubian life, slicing it piece by piece. The high dam came in and drowned every single Nubian village in inside the Egyptian border, and also drowned a bunch of Nubian villages which is the Halfa Valley in the Sudanese border. So you see that blue patch, that's the lake, the reservoir. And this is a very important part of the story we talk about today. The reservoir is called Lake Nasser in Egypt, and Lake Nubia in Sudan. And to us, it's very offensive that it's called Lake Nasser, because it seems like somebody killed you, then they wrote their name on your gravestone. So for today, let me tell you how this lake became the point of our struggle and our fight for land return, and how water remains being the weapon with which the state oppresses Nubians. And this becomes the saddest part in the Nubian story, creating this huge rupture between Nubians who love their water and that water. If you see, look at the last map, this purple patch. This is the 2014 presidential decree that made this entire area a social security, a state security section, and prevented Nubians from coming back and taking their land. And this happens every 30 years. We try to go back and take land and stay by the river, and then they kick us again. But all these times, they keep saying, we don't want you by the river because of environmental concerns. So environmental laws and environmental regulations become weaponized against indigenous people trying to get their land back. So let me tell you some stories from my family, my village, our culture, from Nubian consciousness, and try to convey to you how this kind of violence become manifest in our lives across the history, the contemporary history of Nubians. Now let's start with the first story. Can we go for the first story? Yes. So before displacement, every Nubian newborn had to be taken to the river. It had to be had their faces washed by the water, so baptized. This is the historical roots of baptism. Even this Muslim community still is keen on baptizing their kids. My father was baptized in the river. I was baptized in a water channel next to the displacement village in the 80s. So why would Nubians go do that? Because they would like to go pay respect to the river and the people of the river. People of the river are imaginary, or let's not say, well, imaginary, and imaginary does not mean they are not real. Imaginary creatures within the river that live in there, they have power and they affect our life. To me, these were the ultimate policy in relationship that Nubians have created between themselves and the river. So you have to go and give them food and wash the baby's face with water and pledge and ask for protection for this baby at the beginning of their life. So baptism. That tells you how much water meant to the beginning of the life. And also when we die, we'd be washed by the same river water. So you start at the point of water and you end at the point of water. The next story. So after 1964, when Nubian villages were when all Nubians had been displaced by the state into a state-built resettlement villages, that's where I was born. I always asked myself, and I kept asking people, so what happened to the people of the river? And then what happened to our villages? Because it was the saddest aspect of leaving Nubian villages was leaving dead people in their graves and leaving people of the Nile within the river. The story that is unspoken in Nubian consciousness is that the river started eating itself up, eating its people and eating our dead people and eating our villages. But we really don't know what happened. So is it still the river? And that would become a question that's unanswered. We don't know. Is it still the river? Is it still the Nile? Let's go to the next story. Let's fast forward a bit. But this happened across the early years of displacement all the way until the 1980s when Nubian displacement villages got indoor plumbing and indoor water. Nubian women or Nubians were promised that they're going to go into this modernist paradise where all resources and infrastructures are going to be there available for them. They're going to be there. They're going to find electricity and water and the medical services and all the modernist promises that my colleagues also refer to telling the stories in other locations. As I say, the stories kind of intersect at so many places. So, but this is not what happened. What happened is that the dream of Abdel Nasser was to build a new Nubia, and that new Nubia was there to make the new Nubian, to make a new Nubian that is helpful and useful to the making of the nation state and the economy of Egypt. So his policy was focused on agriculture to make what he called the green factories. So all the resources were dedicated to the agricultural part, all water resources were focused on the agricultural part, and not, and the household was the last part, or was the last space to get water into it. So women like my mother had to go to a public fountain near the agricultural land, fill water buckets, and take it home. They had to perform a lot of filtration techniques on it for them to work. The problem is that water was really infested with leeches, and it was really infested with so many living things. And my mom and my aunt, and they say how they would go to the state agents and clerks that were managing the project in its early years and tell them, please look at this. This water is polluted. How can we drink it? And the clerk would look at the bucket of the water and say, I don't see anything. And they would say, it's in front of you. There is white moving things in the water. And they would say, I don't see anything, and they would leave. This gaslighting, this kind of official gaslighting, but also rupture in relation with water, as if the reality that we see the water that we see is not really the water that they see, and that the water that we deserve is not really what they think that we deserve. And at that point, and with that story, I knew exactly how I understood exactly how the displacement project was implemented. It's by separating Nubians and suspending their realities especially for the early years, so that it can be controlled, altered, and changed into a different space, different Nubia, and with it, the different Nubian that is easily controlled and easily identified as Egyptian, as the useful, good Egyptian. Let's go to the next story. And this image is the women going to the fountain, getting their water, and in the back are the dwelling units by the state. And let's go to the next story. Across the 80s, people started traveling back, the displaced Nubians in Halfa in Sudan, and in the north of Egypt, that became 350 kilometers away from their kin, started to travel back and forth through the Nile again to go see their people. Now they have to sail through the lake and sail over their drowned land. And to this, I would like to invoke and bring forward the important Nubian song that is titled Babur Kosuna, which means the taking the boat into the river. And within the song, the poet talks to the water and asks it, where is our land? What did you do with our land? And starts blaming the dam and asking the dam to break and asking the dam to spill and go away, because he doesn't recognize this land. This is not, where is our land? Where did you take our land? So this still, there is a conversation with water going on. There is still a recognition of the power of water. Water has to do with this. Let me tell you the next story. Displacement villages, 2000s, and I have to say, 90s, and to this day. And if you follow a Nubian group around July, you're going to hear this story again. Every year in the summer, infrastructure, the sewage system around Balena, which is the biggest Nubian settlement village, breaks. every year people drown in sewage water. Every year water erupts. And every year, the only solution that is brought forward is to divert water into the Nile River. And every year, Nubians go and protest and refuse taking spilling sewage water into the Nile River. And every year, they have a very temporary solution, and every year we go through this. It's what, and it water some at some points, and a couple of years ago it went into a 1 meter high into people's houses. So in other some villages you are this high in water because of the bad infrastructure, because how you are separated, and because how the infrastructure did not really take into consideration the actual environment in this area, and it did not really care about that. The care at that time was to build a dam, not to build a good environment for Nubians. And the next one. A group of Sudanese Nubian officials from Halfa took a boat to inspect the river. That boat drowned. And this was a big, big deal around Nubian groups over the internet, the cyber Nubian cyber world. What happened to the river? Why did they drown? And there were all the blame that was landing on the state and how they did not take care of the boats and they were not prepared. But the biggest discussion was that this lake is malicious. This lake is evil. It's not the river anymore. It's not the river ends and then lake starts, but the lake is not the river. There is no river anymore in this port. The river, it's not that the river was dammed. It was that the river was taken away from our consciousness and replaced by an evil beast that we don't recognize anymore. And the last one. This is a It's a folk tale that happens in every house, and my father told me that one day as well. In Arabic, something that's like water means something is very easy. And every time when we go to school and come from our exams, our parents would ask us, how did you do in your exam? We would say, well, it was like water. That means the exam was super easy and I did very well. And Nubian parents would say, cynically, well, water is what got us here, which means you are using the water metaphor as something easy. Just don't forget how water had done us bad and brought us to this point of displacement, to the water that actually had brought us here in a sense of making of Nubian consciousness, became this enemy, has stood at this point of rupture between in our conscious. What does water do when we refuse to take away water's power out of our consciousness, and then it becomes this beast. So through that, through environmental laws, through imposing displacement, through all these spatial interventions, it seems like the state is aiming to control people through environments. On the other side, standing in indigenous epistemes, we see exactly the ramifications of this control and the cuts and the pains and the disrupted relationships with the most important element in Nubians' lives, which was water. So water is the reason we are here. It was the reason we were there and was the reason of life. And it is the reason of we are here as displaced people. And thank you very much.
Okay, sorry, I had muted myself. I was saying thank you so much, Minna, for that incredible talk, and also one that I think brings about the question of time. in both kind of literal fashion in terms of water as origin, in both you know, the sustenance and substance of life, as well as the ways in which it defines futures and forecloses certain possibilities. And that's kind of a really good way maybe to begin to open up to the Q&A. So I think there's going to invite Ameneh and Merve in our panel, in our series. Yeah, and so I think firstly, I just want to say thank you again to all three of you for such inspiring and generative conversations. And I kind of maybe want to think with you here all a bit more and kind of think through the ways in which it touches and intersects in different ways. And so there's one aspect of this, I think, just pulling a bit on Minna's talk and Merve and Emne's as well, in part around the question of the kind of inconsumable or kind of incomprehensible scale of the river, right? And so how this actually seemingly, you know, easy to point to thing is actually incredibly multifarious and dispersed and exceeds not only kind of the words and temporalities that we try and bound it up with, but also it exceeds our ability to predict and understand the ways in which it will behave. And so, I mean, one of the things that I was reading, and I kind of just want to evoke here prior to this talk, was Arundhati Roy, who's an Indian author and scholar, who has written a lot on dams, actually. And then maybe it's also one place that is important to point to as well with everything that's going on in India. And one of the really incredible things, she has a very beautiful essay called The Road to Harsud, which is about a woman that she visited a village that was being designated as to be evicted because the dam that had built was essentially going to flood that area. And what was really incredible about the story was the ways in which the government had mobilized data sets and information from a census that was a few decades old, that had in previous, like in precedents around similar actions, had actually flooded the resettlement places in which they had been told to go to. And I suppose here I'm just not only just evoking this context, but also thinking through again this the question of scale. The question of scale, and both in terms of data, in terms of understanding and comprehending. And I wonder if each of you maybe could speak to maybe what this resonates within your work, but also more specifically, if it helps, to think through the ways in which, as methods and methodologies that you've employed to begin to work through some of these things, right? And so how have you tried to, in a sense, practice the necessary efficiency when one needs to do research in terms of setting up a set of criteria and, you know, defining what's included within your scope and what's excluded and how that's maybe been helpful or frustrating. So I throw that one out there. And while you think about it, maybe I just want to say that the there are questions that if anyone if people have questions in the audience, to type them into the chat, they'll be relayed to us here. And I also just want to flag that there are a few technical delays. So if we hear each other a bit out of sync, it's because of our equally large data set and distributed geographies. So I'll pass it on. I don't know if who wants to maybe take up first.
Yeah, I can start. Really fascinating talks by Merve and Menna, revealing so many connections and parallels, not only in the role of the rivers and water infrastructures, but also the people's relationships to water and how water was weaponized differently, but also resonating in each of our research, I think. So, yes, This is something that I wish I had more time to bring up during the presentation because it's such a big topic. Water in the specific case of Iraq is a very sensitive issue that's currently being debated a lot. So as you know, the main rivers in the country are Tigris and Euphrates, and they originate in Turkey, and one passes through Syria before reaching Iraq. And there are other less major rivers extending from Iran. So Iraq's water is actually not within Iraq's control. Every water infrastructure outside the borders, indirectly or otherwise, they impact what happens in Iraq. So dams and any other hydraulic infrastructures directly impact the surrounding environment where they are built, but by flooding the surrounding villages, by diverting water from one area to another, but also what happens outside. It has this ripple effect, I guess, on all the regions where water extends to. And in the case of the marshes, it's one of the last basins in the region, basically, before it empties into the Persian Gulf. So it's the last area where water will reach. So with every water infrastructure being built outside the river, within Iraq, more water infrastructures will be built to divert water and increase water within that area for irrigation systems and for agricultural projects and so on. So, yeah, for now it's being used as a bargaining chip, I guess, between Turkey and Iraq as like water for oil. Or oil for water, and it's playing a massive role in how much water is going to reach Iraq and especially the marshes. So it's raising questions about how, about who owns water and who owns the river, basically.
If I might add about this idea of ownership, of water, who owns it, but also who owns its meaning, who defines it, who says what water means, and this, I would like to go back to your point of question, Maad, about methodologies and research and finding these sticky, bringing the sticky and the unidentified and undefinable and categorized and taxonomizable into research or environmental sciences that exist predominantly in positivist scientific realms, while trying to look at this from a Nubian epistemic position. I can't look at this without mentioning the people of the Nile. I can't look at this without talking about the river in a sense of personhood. So thinking about indigenous perceptions and pluriversal methodologies and bringing them forward and taking them seriously and thinking about them as valid and important knowledge and really finding the hegemony and the epistemic displacement that comes with positivist sciences in environmental when taking for environmental considerations and how they become themselves a weapon against indigenous people trying to take a river. At the point of scale itself, I would say it has been one of the biggest issues I'm thinking about. I'm thinking I'm never covering this. I don't know the extent of this. It has taken centuries and millennia of emotional labor for this culture to make sense of its river and to build a relationship with it. And I think it's me standing in an indigenous epistemology, I think it's a scientific position to be humble and say, I will never recognize the scale. And there will be always what I don't understand, and that's completely okay. But the point here is that the relationship with my water needs to be healed.
Maybe I can add to this if Menna is finished. One thing to also continue from what Ameneh said before, I remember very well this There was a moment when the Kurdish people also in north of Iraq were actually threatened with the opening of the lids of a dam in north of Iraq, if I'm not mistaken. I mean, so this is, and it's the same, let's say, technique or tactic that was used actually this year, I think, or maybe last year, in the case of Syrian migrants from Turkey towards Europe again. This time, Greece was asking Bulgaria to push the dam that's on Maritsa River up in the mountains that has high water capacity to open the doors of that dam to kind of, let's say, push back the migrants. So in this case, I mean, it's really, you know, talking about language, and also in my case, I'm very interested in the vocabulary of hospitality. It is, in a way, through governmental structures, through a governance, a kind of governance that both takes river and people hostage. So it's not just the people that they take hostage, they take river as hostage, or the other, I mean, they take the river as hostage and they take the people as hostage. So this, to me, it's like this kind of question of expertise and how it looks at the water as something to manage, control the flow of, and use as resource and create energy out of it, and, you know, clean or pollute, or so on and so forth. It's in a way we need to kind of be very careful about our, let's say, solidarities and alliances. So in that case, I bring it to what Menna said before. In that case, for instance, in my relationship with working in Bulgaria, I was very much aware that I was coming as the political heritage of the colonizer, let's say. Just like I am a little bit in this conversation. So, you know, accepting that and then, you know, researching the, showing your side in a way, and then researching to the extent to which you create the solidarities around this regional network. So in the case of Maritsa, all this research was, and from like, you know, even related to Roma people, to who are criminalized simply to keep them away from the water, from the river, you kind of show side to them, and their knowledge is legitimate. And it is the knowledge on the river. The knowledge that comes from the cities across the river, that those are river cities. And that knowledge comes together as the knowledge of the peoples and as the knowledge of the river in this, let's say, regional belonging. And through that, actually, you also kind of deal with the way that your identities are determined for you, and you kind of also confront them.
No, thank you for, yeah, I think it's interesting to bring up the question of property in this moment as well, I suppose. It makes me think, Merve, of the point that you made in your talk, in the ways in which the river gets dissected based on property lines, right? And the ways in which the riverbed versus the side versus the water. And through that kind of management / mismanagement, it becomes no longer the river, right? And so that kind of dismemberment causes also its destitution and destruction, which is, I think, really interesting to think through, actually, the ways in which, I suppose, those like abstract logics of property relations and commodity are at odds with something that the river kind of contests and has to kind of place certain tension on. And it makes me think a lot of other ways in which that relationship to that body of water is construed. And I was thinking a bit, Minna, with yours around the baptism aspect, and to almost also like flip the question, or not the question, but to think through it as a way of, because you have this question of like, is it still the same river, right? And it's like that like what defines and constitutes that river for us? And if this river no longer, in a sense, is acting the way we imagine it to act, and it's no longer you know, doing the things that we have known it to do. But with baptism, it also seems an interesting moment in which you take the river upon yourself, right? It's like you wash yourself and you almost become the river. It's that kind of submergence and that moment of, like, you know, ritual washing that, in a sense, you know, it's you end up as a kind of as a part, as a kind of figure within a larger collective figure. And it makes me think a lot also in terms of, a lot of kind of resistance struggles, for example, within like the Palestinian diaspora and the ways in which one takes the homeland with them. And so here, I think the act of baptism is a really interesting one to think through. And I suppose this is something, to throw another question around this question of like identity, and to pull on all what each of you have said a bit about that kind of cosmology that rivers create, right? And so I think in the Ma'adin with Ameneh, around the ways in which that question of both mineral and, you know, origin and individual, and also the question of like the godliness of it, but also across the three of you, the idea of like deities and river gods, and actually these kinds of spiritual figures that are, in a sense, imbued with a sense of like the qualities that this maybe river has. I think, Merve, again, you had this really beautiful moment where you talked about it from an architectural logic, and how that question of religious practice from something that is ephemeral and replenished to something that's fixed like a shrine, right? So that kind of switch that happens is really beautiful to think through, as also sites of maybe tactics of resistance. So I don't know if you, it's more of a kind of invitation to elaborate further and to think here on those ways in which that kind of cosmology that's constructed around rivers and the things that they begin to order in each of your works. It's something that I'd love to hear more from, because it seems also maybe a moment here to think of tactics of using rivers, right? Because in a sense, these are ways in which they've given, you know, people have allowed and created and made or been given ways of relating to the world through either spiritual practice or other kinds of rituals. So I don't know if,
Maybe I can Menna, go ahead. Now we are suffering from the delay.
Getting a bit of delay. Yeah.
Okay, I'll start. So one is, to me, I put this, I don't know where it will go, but I would like to put this question of trusting the water, let's say, together with or against, or the question of rights. So one thing that was very interesting for me to spend some time in Plovdiv and to see, to try to, you know, to kind of make friends, let's say. One thing I realized was like, one of the things that the Roma used to do was to take permission from the river when they were going to do something. Like when the animal is going to get into the water, they take permission from the water. When they will wash their face with the river water, they take permission from the water. When they are going in on the 5th of May, they take permission from the water. And in turn, the water kind of, gives back to them in a way, or it allows them and so on. So, and this is something that they continue doing. They don't necessarily name this as resistance, quote unquote, but they keep doing this, no matter how far those walls raise between the riverbank and the riverbed. And they try to do this. They try to continue, as even if it became forbidden, for the sake of their security. So decided by the government. So I'm continuously thinking about these kinds of moments where the way we understand the notion of right, whether, I mean, be it the river right, be it the human right, how maybe ill-defined it is in the first place, or, I mean, how we need to re-problematize it and rethink it and redefine it. Yeah, so I'll just put this out there, and that's me.
Maybe Menna and I will
try to speak. Do you hear me? I'm sorry for the delay. Well, speaking about the ritual, there is this very interesting thing that they teach us when we learn how to wash for prayers, for Muslim prayers. So in Muslim prayers, we wash our hand 3 times, and we also drink water and spit it. So we just wash our mouth with water and spit it. And they teach us that we drink water from the river, but spit on land. So we don't spit in the river again. And that's, you see how much respect there is for the river. But my question was, what river? I'm in a displacement village. There is this water channel that is full of bilharzia parasites. I'm not drinking out of that. But they still keep teaching us the ritual, the Muslim ritual combined with the river and its ritual, even though the river is not even here. And even if I get to go to Aswan and reach it, our relationship is going to be brokered by infrastructure and decks and architecture. This kind of visceral relationship that Nubians used to have with water is not there anymore. So I'm not really going to wash for prayers by the water unless I go to the over displaced villages and claim some of that land and wash for prayers there. So there is this kind of amalgamation of ritual that Nubians refuse to give up. I don't know if it's an act of habit. It's never mentioned as a tool, or they never mentioned that you do this when we take our land back and you go by the river. But it's just a part of the ritual. It's the ritual for Muslim prayers has to do with that kind of a little prayer to the river itself, you know? So it was an interesting thing that I wanted to mention when you were talking about the ritual. What does it do? And where things become really at the point of acknowledgement of the power of the river, even though it's not there.
I'm going to jump in. It's very interesting to talk about water as something that spirituality can extend to, and the meaning of water that changes, such as Menna explained, from being for us to being against us. Given how water is influenced, how it's affected by everything that happens to it, that could be miles away across borders, and how water infrastructures impact it, like in how much water reaches us and how much and when water reaches us, who gets nourished by water, who doesn't. It raises the question of how natural is this natural environment? And can we call it a natural environment anymore? So it's an oxymoron, basically. And I use this throughout my whole presentation, describing it as a natural environment, but also knowing that it's not to some extent. So yeah, this also extends to how we connect to it spiritually, as Menna said, and I think it raises this question that, and it calls for an re-examination of our definitions, our terminologies.
No, I think that's a really important point actually to pull on, and I suppose that's kind of on one level ritual acts, but also ritual speech. And the ways in which that kind of articulation of the world, right, of understanding what it is that we're confronted with and our ability to describe it is incredibly powerful. And yet one that is incredibly troubled in this, you know, with the ways in which water behaves and the ways in which it kind of, slips past in many instances. And I think the question of the natural is also one that's really interesting to think about in terms of agency, right? Because I think there's something here around natural systems and the ways in which they construct things, right? And so the agency of Mother Earth, the agency of other kinds of atmospheric forces, of climactic events that have their own periodization, you know, both in terms of annual, but also in terms of millennia. And so there's something here, I think, that it really speaks to in terms of just the, again, it's a question of scale maybe, but also in terms of agency. Yeah, and I think here maybe, I mean, I kind of am interested in all of your examples in the ways in which it really tries, it's that question and that relationship between the people who've historically inhabited it and the ways in which they're trying to be controlled, and subjugated in a sense by extension, through the ways in which the manipulation of the water body that they not only rely on, but also that feeds them in terms of both identity as well as obviously sustenance. And I think in all of yours, it was really this question of the ways in which those tactics were mobilized by individual figures and historical moments, etc. And that kind of strange interplay that begins to happen. And I think one thing that's really powerful in that is not only in terms of the ways in which that physical, tangible thing was being changed, but also the ways in which it was being referred to. I think, as Menna, you mentioned, how Lake Nasser is like writing, the name on your own tombstone, or that kind of the question of actually that name is not just the question of the lake being created, but it's also just like the ways in which one articulates that lake. And then there's obviously a larger aspect to the ways in which those seemingly frictionless and fluid movements are being championed through forms of capitalist exchange and neoliberal market economies, and the ways in which flows and migration policies and other aspects are trying to be understood through these movements, right? And yet they're always obviously reductionist. And so I think there's something here really powerful around agency and the ways in which people are understood and that kind of attempt to control is really fascinating. So I kind of open that up, but I also, I suppose, conscious of time, open it up if you have questions for each other as well. But I suppose thinking through agency and language is also something maybe to respond to.
I will jump in. I'm interested in asking you, Menna, about archives, about resources while doing your research, and how was that process within your methods, within your process, throughout your work? Because in the example of Iraq, it's been very challenging because, first of all the Iraqi government did not release data for obvious reasons. Other forms of archives were lost during wars. Some were ordered to be destroyed. Some were stolen during the American invasion, and they exist now in American institutions and not open up to the public. But on top of all that, also the material that individuals had, they also could not keep because having anything in your possession could be incriminating. So people burned their books at some point. They even dug holes at their homes to bury photographs, books, any documents that could cause you to be guilty by association. So generally people didn't try to keep any documents. And also on top of that, we're also talking about a community that tried to evade the state, so kept their communication, their ways of documenting things are not the same way that we as practitioners, as architects deal with things. They didn't draw maps, they didn't draw Yeah, they didn't relied a lot on oral exchange, generational oral exchange of information. They named every lagoon, every waterway, but it was just names passed on rather than written down. So I'm really interested to also learn about the Nubian experience when it comes to this, when it comes to documentation, when it comes to archives and resources.
Thank you so much, Ameneh, for this question. This was what the biggest struggle I had doing my PhD, which is methodology. Oh, can you hear me? Am I delayed? I'm good. Okay, I'll just continue. I'm so sorry for this. Internet, Egypt, inequality. Anyways, thinking about this in the context of my PhD, because I went in as a researcher, unknowingly an agent of the hegemonic institution that was complicit in the displacement of my people, which is an institution of academia, going in, trying to define methodologies, what knowledge is going to be accessible and what knowledge is going to be brought into my PhD and be validated, which was basically archival material, documentation, quantified knowledge, and all these kinds of things. And to access those, and literature, of course, and literature was full of epistemic violence. Literature was very colonial, whether it's by the Egyptian state or by other international, especially in British literature about Nubia before the 50s, before Egypt became a post-colonial state, and even in anthropology and how people deal with Nubians and talk about Nubians. And to me, there was this kind of a contrast between the story of my grandmother and what a certain anthropologist writes in their books. And I had made the conscious decision to validate and go after and run behind my grandmother's story. And the question was then, what is knowledge? Is it the cadastral map that the British colonizer did to quantify Nubian land and create property people have never quantified before? When my grandmother would give me money, she would ask me, don't count it so that you don't take the blessing out of it. The politics of quantification was really frowned upon. And that's an episteme. That's a way of making knowledge, some kind of knowledge. And there is the cadastral map that was created to see how much money the British colonizer can extract out of our land. So which one of them is the knowledge on which I rely? And I had made the conscious decision to let my foremother's voice ring in my head and validate that kind of knowledge. And from that, understand what it means to build, what it means to make space, and what is a Nubian space, and what is a Nubian place, and also put them in contrast and make explicit the difference, or make explicit the contrast and the confrontation between my grandmother telling me the other names of the Nagas in our village that were erased by the state when we got moved into a displacement village that has just compiled everybody in one pot of a built environment that is a rectangle, a linear row housing system. And validate these names, even though there is no document, state documents of them. And let me say F state documents that my grandmother's mention, and everybody in the village being able to mention the names of these places, means they exist and they deserve to be recognized in my thesis. And this is the kind of knowledge that I would like to produce and present and go and look after and pursue. So, to me, it was the biggest confrontation. Sorry for going on and on, because this was the biggest confrontation. And it came at the point of asking myself, what do I want to do in academia? And knowing that there is existing indigenous knowledge, and knowing that the indigenous academics had went in and confronted hegemonic epistemologies and have taken themselves outside of epistemic displacement. And they have employed plurireversal lenses, both methodologically and in data collection and in data acquisition, and even taking them out of these very rigid terms of data collection and data acquisition. This has been the project that I decided to pursue.
Thank you, Menna. I have so many questions for all of you, for Moad's film that is being screened now, for Merve's research, and more about Nubian. Hopefully we can carry on these conversations later.
It was a really beautiful, so many more questions to think through. And also just like that question of kinship and with rivers as well, it's so powerful. Also in question of rights, I mean, there's so much. I'm not sure how we're doing for time. I will ask the question that I have here in the chat as maybe the last question. And it's a question from Margarita, who asks, I was thinking about the Aras or Arrakis or Arax River, name changes depending on where you're from, that starts in Turkey and then flows along the border between Turkey and Armenia, between Turkey and Nakhchivan, area of Azerbaijan, between Iran and both Azerbaijan and Armenia, and finally through Azerbaijan to the river Kura. These are historically and very recently areas of contestation and violence. But could we imagine a potentiality for connection and solidarity through the river? That's, I think, a beautiful question to kind of finally ask the three of you in this moment, and to think through, affirming and aligning, I suppose, in this moment of global resistance in many cases. So I kind of, maybe I direct this one to Merve, and then maybe also if anyone else wants to jump in, they can jump in.
This is the most difficult question. I mean, especially giving the example of Aras River because I think that border is closed between Turkey and Armenia for more than a decade, if I'm not mistaken. And again, another question of taking hostage and isolating peoples from each other. It's really... through so many anniversaries and memories that kind of comes back continuously. But actually, I mean, this kind of, the question of solidarity, for me, actually, more and more important than, for instance, a question of alliance among peoples. And also a little bit actually in relation to what Ameneh was asking before about research methodologies. I think it's really to make space as much as possible for creating the space of agency, or like, let's say, facilitating the space of agency or facilitating the space of representation, facilitating the space for the subject to talk, facilitating the space for legitimate arguments among those who have shared land and water and air and for so much time. So the for instance, in the case of, I mean, this is an essential question in the case of Menna, for instance, because it's her PhD, but for instance, my engagement with Marisa River and in relation to that, the peoples and let's say the human and non-human relationship, I had to deal with them through a festival, which actually creates more space in a way to kind of, to create more space in ways that methodologically you can even walk at the edge of controversy. But even, you know, taking the risk of falling into unethical directions, you kind of try to put something forward or make something happen or facilitate a certain relationship to happen, so on and so forth. So I hope this wasn't a very complicated response. I don't know the, it's a very good question, and I have, it's a very sad question for me at the same time, especially in the context of Aras. But at least looking for more ways to create solidarities would be the, as simple as possible, my interpretation or response to the question.
No, thank you for that. I think that's, an incredibly thoughtful, I think, way to also consider, I think, as you mentioned, the kind of real importance of solidarity in space, and also that kind of inversion where rivers actually provide spaces, you know, something that maybe is not immediately obvious, but actually not only as places of connection, but also as, you know, ways in which things are actually enacted and the ways in which they host things. There's a few more questions. There's questions around the legal personhoods given to rivers. And I think that's something that's really fascinating to talk about. But I, in the interests of time, as I think we could be here until for a few more hours, I think I will just thank you all again so much for sharing the work and for the invitation and for Sonic Act and Ameneh. And then hosting this. And I know that we have a incredible DJ coming up session. And I think in the spirit of like the multidimensional, multimodal experiences that we're all kind of here participating in and almost necessary to even talk about, engage with in this topic. I just really, just want to say thank you again and leave it to, I think it's Margarita, or Skinner.
Thank you, everyone. That actually, the last question was for me, and I'm also just thinking about the responses to it. As Merve, Merve's kind of beautiful response. Also, that it's kind of a sad question. But also I was trying to imagine these kinds of potentialities that are inherent in the river and the way it sort of moves and flows. And thank you so much. It was really a pleasure also to just sit here and listen to all of these talks. Just wanted to do a lot of thank yous. Big thank you, of course, to everyone who joined us tonight, who is watching, for all the thoughtful questions from the audience, even if those questions maybe were just inside your heads and you didn't post them. Sometimes it's also important just to think about these things. Big thank you to the Sonic Act team, who worked really hard to put this event together, all the beautiful transitions you saw, and how everything flowed. Thank you for the technical production team here in the studio, to the Boromora, Igor Dubryasek and Carl Mubarak for the live stream and website design and development and the beautiful videos made for the event. Of course, a really big thank you to Ameneh, to Menna, to Merve and Moad for sharing their knowledges, research, stories. And I really love this term that Menna had mentioned, these conversations with water, which I think we really engaged with a lot tonight. Just a little reminder to not forget to watch Moad's film, Turbulent Flow, which is going to continue to play in 30-minute loops until tomorrow at midnight, Central European summer time. So before Laser Gazer takes over, I just want to remind those of you who, Reinder, for those of you who were in our last event, because I already mentioned this, but Ecos, which is a new periodic magazine from Sonic Acts about art in the age of pollution, is now available in our web shop. I actually just seeing it for the first time physically. I have it here. It's really beautiful. definitely highly recommended to get it. This magazine continues Sonic X's emphasis on artists and thinkers that propose alternatives to the anthropocentric view that sees Earth and the non-human world as an endless resource, and features interviews, visual essays, and texts by artists and researchers such as Arjuna Newman, Kaiveli Mavrokordopoulou, and Cecil Mariton. You can also still experience Cecil's interactive audio walk, Plastic Hypersea, at the NDSM Wharf, or what has now been actually transformed into Amsterdam's vaccination center. This piece, which is set in the year 2099, is a spatial and interactive experience that imagines the environment as an extension of our immune systems and contemplates on ways in which our bodies are entangled with microplastics and the sediments of Amsterdam's waterways. You can access the walk via your mobile phone or by scanning the QR code at the location, and you can find all the details on the Sonic Acts website. And also, please keep an eye out for our new podcast series in collaboration with Yaya Ney Ney Ney, in which our overexposed artists in residence, including tonight's curator and speaker Ameneh Solati, speak about the artifacts that have moved their practice in a lasting way. In the first episode, which is now out, Arjuna Newman speaks about environmental struggles and tenderness. And our next live event will actually be on Tuesday, June 22nd. So we're deviating from the Saturday night structure, mainly because it's summertime and we thought it was a better idea to have it on a Tuesday. So this event is entitled Nuclear Unknowns, and it will take us down the complex path of radioactive pollution, exploring the subject's ecological, artistic, and geopolitical tangles. During an evening of screenings and performances, artists and curators will discuss different strategies to grapple with nuclear energy's uneven and calamitous aftermath. The event will be moderated by Kaiveli Mavrokordopoulou, who's also featured in our Ecos magazine, as just mentioned. Kaiveli is an art historian, writer, and curator. Is currently finishing a PhD at the School of Advanced Studies in the Social Sciences in Paris, working on the subterranean imaginary contemporary art, especially concerning nuclear spaces. She's contributed to various projects about nuclear technologies at the Environmental Humanities Center at the Vrije Universiteit in Amsterdam, where she co-organized the interdisciplinary event series, Nuclear Waste Weeks. And Kaiveli currently teaches a seminar on art and nuclearity at the art school in Calais, Dunkirk, with Agnes Villet, with whom she's working on a series of toxic tours across nuclear infrastructures in France. And we've also invited artist Ines Halabi to join the conversation, and we'll be screening Ines's film, We Have Always Known the Wind's Direction, which probes the possible burial of nuclear waste in the south of the West Bank. And other speakers will be announced very soon. So mark your calendars for that event. It's going to be a bit of like a nuclear end to the season here in Amsterdam before we take a short summer break. And with all of that out of the way, I'm really happy to welcome Laser Gazer here in our studio for a special performance inspired by tonight's topic. Laser Gazer is an Amsterdam-based artist and DJ who always brings a contagious mix of sounds and emotions. So we're really excited to pass this space over to her now. Thank you so much and have a good night. Bye.